Okay, thank you for a brief introduction. The rest, if anybody interested, is on my website. And the talk today, I wanted also to give some kind of bird's eye view on the topic, because we are talking about the details. How can we improve by 3%, 4%? Now, brain-computer interface has definitely gone mainstream. 2 years ago, we had announcement from Facebook that they will easily do 100%, 100 words per minute brain-computer interface based probably upon some kind of optical imaging. It was announced, then for some time we did not hear anything. Then after half a year we heard that Regina Dagan, who was leading the project, resigned, and we don't hear anything more. So when money talks, actually this brain-computer interface business, because we had talk about business applications, business interest in brain-computer interface. Now, companies developing this most hyped brain-computer interface, or claiming to develop most efficient brain-computer interface, are multi-billion club. 100 million is the entry point usually. So another well-known competitor in the field is, of course, our favorite Elon Musk with Neuralink, which again 2 years ago announced that they will be making this nobody knows what. There was a silence for 2 years, and what they came up with actually is some kind of electrocorticography. Of course, it is very nicely improved. This robot that they made can avoid blood vessels, have higher resolution, larger number of channels, but why the press is saying that this is exactly what we missed to download the content of your brain to a hard drive, I cannot tell you, because when you look at the history, 15 years ago, this was even way before, but 15 years ago we had this first electrocorticography thing, so you would say that the improvement is significant, but it is quantitative rather than qualitative. The basic issues are still unsolved. So let's get back to our humble scientific work. To make things less boring, I proposed this kind of controversial title for one of the presentations. Actually, it's not my presentation, it's Marian Dowdiało. And I will make a little bit of advertisement for this demo that will be available today. And also I will show you what are we trying to really improve the state of art, and also remove some of the hindrances that we heard about in the previous talk. Maybe not so expensive user-centered, not so expensive way to make specific interface for every user, but still things can be improved according at least to our experience. So the presentation, the demo, D14, will be based upon our recent article about, it's about BCI illiteracy, the term that's been widely used and established in a scientific literature about BCI, and people write that on the average, something like 20, maybe 30% of the users are BCI illiterate, which means cannot use any brain-computer interface. And this is basic question, because if somebody cannot use BCI, well, what it means? So, it turns out, from our experience at least, from my experience, from what I was seeing at the conferences, at European project, in the laboratories, if somebody cannot use the brain-computer interface, it usually means that he's not getting the state-of-the-art treatment, he's not getting the right hardware, he's not getting the right software, or he's not using the right paradigm. We tested 30 subjects with several paradigms: visual, audio, tactile, P300, SSVEP, and we did not find anybody who was not able to use any of those interfaces. Of course, there is a lot of issues beyond that. Some people need larger spaces between stimuli, some people need to understand, some people need larger calibration scheme, but this should not be termed illiteracy. So we concluded the article with the Finetti's paraphrases that BCI illiteracy does not exist, and I will also show you now how do we achieve this kind of effects using solid engineering and implementation of state-of-the-art science. So first hindrance that we heard about a few minutes ago is, of course, the head cap, the gel and everything. Now in the company, we had developed a head cap that you can put on, maybe not in 1 second, but it is general. You don't have to 3D model every head. It's adjustable for water-based electrodes. And as you see, I was presenting this at the Nensky conference. You get alpha wave nicely after brief time, and the quality of signal is incomparable to toys like a Motif or anything else. It's 24-bit amplifier. Now you may say, especially now, I'm a perfect subject. On my head, you can put EEG in seconds, but we took a real challenge, and this is probably the toughest challenge you can get with African hair, and it also worked like a charm. Here you see the classifier accuracy, and this is another, this gadget that you see here on the phone is showing the crucial information online. That's another observation that we have had going with brain-computer interface to hospitals, to clinics, to normal users, that, okay, you put on the cap, on your laptop you have the stimuli and something does not work. What does not work? Maybe the electrode does not work. Maybe the user is sleeping. Maybe something is disconnected. Well, so you turn thing off. Usually you take the data home and you see, one electrode did not contact. Or maybe, the user was sleeping, there was huge alpha. Or the user was not performing at all and we should not use the whole hour to keep the poor guy. So we have this, what we call BCI control panel, which in real time shows you the most important information. Of course, you can tailor what, but the important thing is that you'd have it on a separate device. It can be another laptop, smartphone, or anything, and you can immediately see whether during the calibration, for example, you have improving classifier certainty, you have event-related potential, and during the performance, during the session, also you have for each, as you have we were seen before, for each stimuli you have online increasing classifier accuracy. So these two things are probably the major technical achievements that on the way to really comfortable, unobtrusive brain-computer interface. And now having this kind of things, we were able to go into real-world applications. And example application I would like to talk about here is research on disorder of consciousness. There are patients usually after coma that we cannot communicate with. The basic problem of medicine is that without communication, we cannot optimize therapy, we cannot optimize rehabilitation. Basically, we do not know if the treatment works. There are several places when people with disorder of consciousness, usually after coma or stroke, are kept, taken care of, cured, but we really don't know if it works. From time to time, we get in a newspaper, another awakening in the Budzik clinic or whatever, but the truth is that some of those patients would come out of this state also by themselves, and we cannot really see whether given therapy works or not. And this is one of the examples, because now I still remember the title, where the BCI is heading. This is one of the examples where BCI technology helps, but frankly, it's not exactly a BCI. It's just good old EEG and evoked potentials. But, okay, BCI sounds better. So we did not have any introduction here about basic introduction on BCI. So to cope with it, we just prepared the English version of our introductory webpage on braintech.pl, where we have explained workings of basic paradigms of brain-computer interface, and we used just one single example of P300 BCI, which is basically flashing the most basic thing. Yeah, the information is bits, yes or no, zero or one. The most basic information transfer is if user counts yes or no for children in, for example, for comatose children is flashing the Donald Duck and the Mickey Mouse, and we ask kid, please count how many times have you seen Mickey Mouse, okay? And then we take these average potentials, and if we average potentials for Mickey Mouse and have significant P300, that gives us a huge amount of information. We know that the patient heard the command. We know that the patient can consciously process the command. He's able for cognitive tasks like counting, etc., etc. So this, normally, we use this for communication. Yeah, we choose yes, we choose left or right or whatever. But here, using basically the same software and the same hardware, we achieve diagnosis of states that with classical tools, with behavioral tools, reach almost half of misdiagnosis. And this is the only way to get information directly from the brain. And there are papers, and also we have more on this if somebody is interested on post-repeat 34. It will be part of this research that we talk about. Now, the bird eye view again. Brain-computer interface has become something like an umbrella term for a lot of technologies that are used in business, science, technology, clinics, hospital, or whatever. The nice thing about BCA is really the renaissance of electroencephalography. That because EEG was getting less and less popular, nice imaging techniques like fMRI or PET were showing things exactly how the doctors learn it. It was particular structure, it was easier to interpret. With EEG, it's not so easy to interpret, but EEG has several advantages, and the umbrella of brain-computer interface can be also seen. I would say that BCI for EEG is more or less like, for example, car races to the motor industry. It's, as we're hearing, not many people are using BCI actually. Yeah? There are not many users. There are not many direct users of BCI. Yet the technology developed within this funny race. Hey, I made it 5 bits per minute faster than the other guys. I'm better, yeah? What does it serve for? Oh, it was extremely motivated PhD students who was training for 5 weeks for some kind of performance hit. So if you look from this side, it makes very little sense. And also car races make very little sense. But the technology that is developed over there really can help in road safety, efficiency, etc. And one of the examples of this kind of technology that was developed for BCI is steady-state visual potentials stimulator, which we started developing some years ago when we were in a project that involved BCI based on steady-state visual evoked potentials. As you probably know, SSVEP is the fastest paradigm, but you should not use it in the low frequencies because it can induce photoepileptic attack. So it's definitely better to use high frequencies, high starting 30 hertz, 40 hertz. This is safe and also significantly less annoying. However, the problem, it was quick here. Oh, this is how originally the guys from Philips started to work on this high frequency. It was classical by then. You had hardware controls, LED flashing. Why hardware control? Of course, on a computer screen, you cannot efficiently render frequencies like 32 and 33 hertz because of the refresh rate, because of the operating system, etc., etc. So we have hardware showing you these frequencies. And this is, of course, not very efficient. This is like a bank teller approach. So we actually, hard to say why nobody made it before like this, but we just put these LEDs behind the computer screen, and there was the first device of this kind from on CBIT in 2012. That was at that time the fastest brain-computer interface owing to this owing to the natural speed of steady-state visual evoked potential, because this is a parallel interface with many things flashing at the same time to choose from. And also it was safe BCI because it was high frequency, not annoying and not giving a danger of inducing photoepileptic attack. Now, after some time, we developed this into way more fields with better electronics, better synchronization, and now we have this 320 segments of a screen that can be independently highlighted with frequencies of your choice. And here probably the calibration method that we heard before based on multi-armed bandit would be a very nice approach to choose the frequencies which are most frightening for a given user. But surprisingly, this device opens new ways, new possibilities of research or maybe also entertainment, because if you highlight given section of a screen with given frequency and you see this frequency in EEG, then you know that the user looking at the screen and on top of this flashing LEDs, you can have a movie, you can have advertisement, you can have text, you can have whatever. And if we detect in EEG the frequency related to this particular corner of the screen, we know that the user was not just looking at it like it is the case with eye tracking, but we also know that the user, or we even know that the user was concentrating his or her attention on this part of the screen, on this symbol, on this image. So this opens completely new possibilities of investigating attention focus as opposed or correlated with eye tracking technology that show you what the user was looking at. And this technology will be presented today evening at demo D14. Of course, it doesn't mean that if one of you comes and cannot use the BCI, that contradicts our main thesis, because we don't have here, first of all, we don't have here all the paradigms implemented. We'll be having, as far as I remember, only visual P300 and SSVEP maybe. So this is not the complete test. If you fail, you're still not BCI illiterate. You shouldn't worry. Yet the head cap and the blinker will be available. And since I finished 2 minutes before, we have time for question. Thank you.
This approach using very high frequency SSVP is very interesting. What is the maximum limit of frequency? You know, from physiology, we know that the brain should respond to 100 hertz, but EEG cannot pick up the gamma. So usually, you know, the power is 1/F, so they go. So I wonder, okay, this is very important what you emphasize, that high frequency in SSVP is extremely important because not only reduce annoying, but also epilepsy problem and other things which you already mentioned. But I understand that this is, you want above 30 or 35 hertz. But what is the highest limit, and how is possible to increase this upper bound, if any way?
Well, first of all, you should ask, why would you want to increase the upper bound? And it would be in rare cases if you want to have, I don't know, very, very many buttons on the screen. It's very user specific. And that's why in the calibration, we're choosing the particular frequencies that given user is responding to. And also, basically, you replied to yourself, partly thank you for this, mentioning the 1/F characteristic of EEG signal. And of course, in higher frequencies, EEG can pick up higher frequencies, indeed, but that would require probably very good skin preparation, low impedances. So traditionally, we usually don't go with this European upper bound of 50 hertz where you have network. And between this 30, 35 or 50 hertz, we usually find enough frequencies, because the response, of course, the lower frequency, the stronger the response. And of course, the fastest SSVEP BCIs that you are seeing are in low frequencies. Yeah? They take in the risk, but they have way, way stronger response. So you can have shorter periods, faster BCI. And if you don't hit the alpha, of course, you have best responses over there. But basically, we usually don't go above 50, and the technical details you can get from Marian on the presentation.
OK, Okay, yep. Maureen?
To follow up on this same topic, does a blinker allow to do a code-based visual evoked potential, which are not at a constant frequency, but which use like barcodes type of
Yes. Technically, yes. We did not yet program this, but there is a driver for this, so we can program anything. And this is a very good thing. This is apart from this very elegant multi-arm bandit approach to calibration, which I thank you for mentioning. It's very nice. Apart, this is probably the next thing that we should be trying, or anybody who wants to use the device. Yeah, again, technical details, Marian is the best source.